How's everybody doing? Can you hear me in the back? Yeah, okay. We good? All right, thanks everybody for waiting. Let's get this party started. So we'll start with a quick welcome. Welcome to the fourth episode of the Boat Code Talk Show. This is our fourth one. This is this is a monthly exploration of the diverse, creative, and entrepreneurial talent that resides right here in our backyard, right here in our community. There's so much of it. The show's goal is to contribute to a better world, starting with our own community, and by inspiring future leaders, innovators, and influencers with stories of positivity, perseverance, and hard work. And we hope that you leave here with some real life lessons. That's the whole goal. So I'm Derek Sabori, I'm your host, and we're thank you.
Thank you.
And first I'll say off script, it's great to see students here. We've got university, community college, we've got friends, old friends, new friends. This is an amazing crowd and a really eclectic crowd, and I'm glad you guys are all here, so thank you. Let's see, so we're here again at the amazing dining and cocktail experience that is the Boathouse Collective. So if this is your first time here, welcome. We hope that you become a regular. We hope that you come back. And I know a lot of you guys have said, this is my first time here, so please come back. This is an amazing place. And if you're already a regular, then you know why this place is so special. From their commitment to the craft cocktail, to the culinary arts, culinary excellence, to music, art, and culture, and community events like this, the Boathouse has become kind of a crown jewel of our community. So come back and support them. And so with that, I owe a big thanks to Clay Peterson, the entire Boathouse staff and family for allowing us to have this show. This is an exciting thing, and I'm grateful to be up here. So can we give a warm round of applause to the whole staff and the family at Boathouse? So without further ado, we'll get down to, let's get this party started. Tonight's guest has a story and a career journey, and you've been watching some of the slides up here, and many of you know our guest tonight. He has a story and a career journey that has intrigued me for years. He's a person of many enviable talents, experiences, and relationships, both personal and professional. And at key points, his life is intertwined with and positively impacted mine in many ways, which we'll share. He's been a professional surfer, a competitive multi-sport athlete, a musician, a filmmaker, a marketing executive for one of the most famous action sports brands in the world, featured in a recent viral surf clip, which you saw up there on the wall. He's a father to three amazing girls, and now in a second act of sorts, he's a brand entrepreneur. All this, and he's one of the most humble people that I know. He's a friend, and in full transparency, my business partner. But I'd like to introduce and welcome Troy Eckert.
I have my wine.
We've got our wine. Quick sound check
for
Troy.
Oh, this is heavy. Hello. Hi, Derek.
Okay, hi, Troy. Okay, so welcome, Mr. Eckert. And this is a nice break. Because normally we'd be sitting here, we'd have our laptops out, we'd be like going through the to-do list of what we have to do and what we have to get done. Mm-hmm. But tonight, this is just a talk. We're just gonna have some fun. And for now, we just want to take a break, talk a little story, share some of your experiences, your journey with old friends and new friends here.
Sounds good.
Sound good?
Let's do it.
So first of all, thank you for agreeing to be on the show. I know I kind of tugged and pulled, and we hit up Troy a few times.
He did.
He's like, yeah.
He definitely did.
He
good
said,
job.
Maybe, and then you did it. And we packed the house with your...
So thank you guys for coming.
People are excited to hear you. So, but I will say, like I said, this is the fourth show that we've done. And a quick plug, I mean, we've had some fun guests. We had Jeff Yokoyama, Yoki, as you know, he was the first guest. Cole Cresselius, our second guest, he's the CEO at Crochet Kids. Then we had Danny Thompson, the drummer for Face to Face, and he runs a music school here in the area. And now you, Troy Eckert, my friend, we've got a lot of stuff to cover because you, the third employee of Volcom,
That's right.
Global brand builder, principal co-founder of the brand Cosm right behind you. So we've got a lot to get through tonight.
All right, let's do it.
You ready?
Yeah.
You need a drink of wine or anything?
Sure.
Let's do that real quick.
Cheers.
So Troy and I talked about maybe like bringing up a bottle of wine and we would just keep drinking and talking and seeing what happened. But we decided to take the professional approach. So Troy, is this your first retrospective interview like this?
I would say yes, in public, definitely.
All right.
Live.
So here's the thing, what I want to start with is for how many accomplishments that you've had, there's not that much out there. So, I mean, luckily, we sat down and we went through and I've known you for a lot of years, but I actually didn't know a lot about you, so it's been fun to dive in and about the behind the scenes of you, I should say, but there's not a lot out there on Google, for example, about you.
Yeah.
You Google Troy Eckert, and it's not like, boom, all these things come up. So have you always been a private person? And would you say you're a private person in that sense?
I would say, yeah, definitely. I've just been, I don't know, I like to sort of let my actions speak louder than words for the most part. So for sure, been pretty private over my course of my life. I would say yes, definitely.
Okay, well, we're broadcasting this, we're Instagramming it live.
Not anymore.
So, yeah, private. Having known you for so long, I've always been so impressed. But there's so many things that you're good at. And not just good, but like really good, like multiple time winner of, you know, multi-sport challenges, surfer cross, H2O Classic, surfing, snowboarding. So where did you learn these things? Where did you learn to surf, ride moto, drums? Where did this all come from?
I don't know. That's a really good question. I mean, surfing basically kind of fell into my lap. It wasn't really anything I was like, I'm going to be a professional surfer or anything like that. I was living in Lake Forest at the time, inland, and my dad basically, you know, surprised me with the surfboard one day, and then all of a sudden I was at Doheny, and that's where I learned to surf, was in Doheny when I was about 10 years old. And I just instantly fell in love with it. So it was literally like that. At that moment, I was like, I just want to surf. Like, that's what I want to do in my life, basically. I knew the ocean was a part of my life from the very beginning, for sure.
And you were hooked from there. So your surfboard came first, and then the desire for the sport.
Absolutely, yeah. And I don't even know how I even knew about it. Just back then, it was like, you know, you're just a kid in Lake Forest, and you know, there's just magazines. Like, I don't even really remember. I don't really have anything that really resonates with me. It was just more about like wanting a surfboard, getting to the ocean, and all of a sudden just like finding surfing, basically.
How were you getting to the ocean? Were you taking the bus like I was?
It was my dad in the beginning and my mom as well. And
yeah.
They'd bring me down there. Like, my parents didn't surf. No one surfed. And yeah, it was just kind of a random thing.
Do you remember your first surfboard?
I do. It was a twin fin San Miguel that I got from, my dad brought it to me from the original, not the Frog House. What was the one? It was on Balboa. I'm drawing a blank of the old. What was not Russell, but God, I'm totally, it's gone. It's completely gone. It was an old surf shop. Small Faces?
Yeah, I was going to say
Small
that,
Faces.
I had a Small Faces board, so but I thought there was a shaper.
That's where I got the board from. And,
awesome.
Yeah.
And so then at what point then does it turn? So what are some of your earliest memories though of sort of becoming though, where you realized that you were an athlete or that you had skills? Did you play other sports? Was it all surfing or were there other sports that you were playing?
Before that, soccer. Okay. I really liked soccer. Yeah, I did pretty good doing that. I like to
position?
Run around.
What position?
I was center forward.
Center forward.
I liked that, but you know, I got bored with it, I guess, and then found the surfboard and that was it. So
okay.
Yeah.
And then, so surfing has always, it's played a huge role in your journey, right? And so, I mean, how is surfing intertwined with your professional career, your personal life? You know, has it been something that's always a pursuit that you've had? And is it something that's always on your mind? Is it come and go, or has it been steady ever since that first?
It's an addiction. It's steady always. I'm just always thinking about how the waves are, or me missing out on something, or
surf anxiety.
Constantly. Yeah, absolutely, all the time. So it's always on my mind.
Do you remember your first wave?
I don't, but I know it was at Doheny, so I don't remember like a specific wave. Actually, my mom took photos. I have like photos of like that first session. It's pretty cool. So
nice.
I have a huge wide stance and look horrible. So yeah, it's cool.
And then how about in those early days, what about school? What was school like for you? What were you like as a school kid?
I was not good in school.
Why?
I just was...
And not why, but wasn't. Like, why? How could you have done that? Like,
I don't know if you want to go there. No. Yeah, I don't know. I just bounced around a lot. Like when I was younger, my parents moved all over the place, and my parents got divorced when I was 10, so kind of just, you know, didn't have much parental early on, and, you know, school just wasn't a main focus in my head, and I just wanted to go to the ocean and go to the beach. Honestly, it was like kind of my getaway was the beach.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I wasn't a very good student.
Was there a subject, though, that stood out in your mind that you appreciated the most?
I love ceramics.
Ceramics. Do we have any ceramics fans? Any art majors? Okay, see?
I just love to spin and just, you know, create and just be on the wheel and just put it in the kiln and see what
comes out. When's the last time you got behind the wheel?
It's been a long time.
All right.
I would love to do it again.
Yeah, there's a local place
here. I know, I heard about it. I was all stoked.
Yeah, yeah. But so at one point though, you were as you got older, you got to a point where you were on the path to being possibly a professional surfer and becoming a professional surfer.
Yeah.
Did you consciously, you know, was that something just sort of slowly evolved, or did you get a bug and you were just like, you know what, I'm gonna start competing. This is what I want, and this is how I'm gonna make money.
No way. It was more of like kind of, I mean, before I moved to Newport, I lived in Huntington, and Bolsa Chica was kind of like my go-to spot, and it was just the magazines and seeing my heroes like Aki and just who Kong and whoever else was doing what they were doing at the time, Tom Curran, Tom Carroll, all those guys, and I just remember seeing them and just being like, oh my God, that's amazing. I want to like go and just, I want to be, I don't know if I ever said I want to be a professional surfer, but I knew I wanted to like try to surf contests, and all my friends were doing contests, so I was like, it was kind of like the natural thing to do, and I could always hitch a ride with my friends and their parents and just go to contests and surf, and did, you know, fairly well.
You did all right.
Yeah.
What was your first contest?
I don't remember.
And how'd you do? You don't remember?
I don't remember.
Do you remember the first contest that you did well in?
Not
first
really.
First trophy?
Yeah, I mean, no.
Okay, all right, First big loss?
I'd lose all the time. So it was like, you know, it was all good.
All right. Are any of your arch rivals like out here from those early days?
Mesa. Totally.
So at some point, though, so even though you don't remember the earliest times, but at some point, though, you make it onto the NSSA National Surf Team. That's mm-hmm. a big deal in surfing.
At the
right?
time, it was a big deal.
Yeah, so what was that like? What an experience that must have been.
Yeah, it was
Tell me
cool.
some of the highlights of that and how that happened.
Yeah, it was just like NSSA was sort of the gateway of, you know, to get to the next level into professional surfing or whatever. So I did fairly well in that. And then, you know, they choose a different team every year. And then all of a sudden they basically pick me. And so I was on the team and we would do different contests and things like that. And it was a super fun experience. You know, it was like, I don't even remember how many people. It was like 12 or 13 people that would go and compete against other teams and whatnot. So it was cool.
Did you get to do some traveling?
Yeah, I did. And that's kind of, I feel like that actually might have been the beginning of sort of my traveling experiences.
Yeah.
Like, I remember going to Cabo with the national team. And I mean, we were just rats. We were like, you know, 13, 14 years old or so young. And just having a fun time.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And so the travel bug got you at an early age, would
yeah,
you say?
Yeah, definitely. Definitely early on.
So how long were you on the NSSA team? How long are you sort of competing and going through that phase of your life?
I think I was on it just for 1 year.
Okay.
I was just on it for a year. Yeah.
And so at that point, do you have any idea? School's not really your thing. You're surfing, though. Because
mm-hmm.
at some point, you get to the early 90s.
Mm-hmm.
You're graduating high school-ish.
Mm-hmm.
And you meet Richard Wolcott and Tucker Hall.
Yeah.
Right, who were, at the time, the co-founders of Volcom, the action sports brand. And so I'll leave it at that. What was that like? At what point did you meet those guys?
Well,
who did you meet first? Did you meet...
Well, I met Wooly first.
Okay.
I had just gotten on Quicksilver. I think it was probably like my junior year. I think actually, yeah, I was on Quicksilver when I was on the national team. So it was like around my junior year
okay.
in Newport Harbor High School. And then, you know, I got into my senior year and I met Wooly. Robbie Todd was my team manager at the time for Quicksilver. So I was introduced to Wooly, who was the marketing director at Quicksilver at the time. So I remember like bonding with Wooly we kind of got on from the beginning, and then all of a sudden, you know, I was nearing the end of my senior year of high school, about ready to barely graduate, and he had quit. He quit Quicksilver, and he like a couple months later was like, you know, I was like, oh, where'd Wooly go? I was bummed, you know, because I remember I really bonded with him. And then all of a sudden he basically approached me and was like, you know, a few months later probably, and was like, hey, I'm starting this thing, and it's called Volcom. And I'm like, okay, like, what is this thing, you know? And he's like, here, check it out. And he had a sticker. Like, it was just a sticker. Like, that was it. It was a sticker. I'm like, this is a cool sticker, like, rad logo. And the stone had been created at that point. Okay. So I saw the stone, and I saw it was the oval Volcom sticker. And I was like, that's pretty cool. Like, I like that, you know? And so basically, gosh, I forget what else happened at that. Yeah, so Wooly and Tucker... you know, Tucker was working for Quicksilver also at the time, and he got fired. He was a rep. And he had gotten fired. So both of those guys actually, sort of kind of backtrack a little bit, both those guys, when they both, well, Wooly quit and Tucker got fired, they sort of took off on a snowboard sabbatical in Tahoe. So they went to Tahoe and just freaking snowboarded for like, I don't even know, like, you know, whatever, a month straight. And that's where the idea came up. Of Volcom was in Tahoe when those guys were snowboarding. Yeah. So then they came back and then got to the beach, and then that's when Wooly sort of approached me and was like, hey, do you want to be involved with this thing? And at that point it was Wooly, you know, in his room with his desk was a door, like off of his door in his house. He took his door off the house and put it on cinder blocks, and that was his desk in his room. And to the day that Wooly left Volcom, he had the same desk.
Same desk.
25 years with that same desk. Pretty awesome. So, I remember him, like, you know, coming to his house, and he's in his room, and he's got, like, a box with, like, random T-shirts and whatever. He's just, like, pulling stuff out. I'm like, that looks cool. And, you know, long story short, he just wanted me to be a part of it. And I was getting paid like $200 a month, you know, which was pretty good for being 18 and almost out of high school. And like at that time in 91, I was like, this is killer. I'm making $200. And I remember going to my dad and asking him like what his thoughts were about the whole thing. And he was like, you're crazy. You have like an incredible thing going with Quicksilver. Why would you ever leave right now? And for some reason I was like, you know what? I'm probably just angst to my dad, like number one, and number two, I liked Wooly, so I was like, I'm gonna try this out. And so I was the first, you know, team rider, employee, whatever, at Volcom.
So it was just the three of you guys at that point.
Yeah, it was just three of us.
And was there something in your gut that, or was it just sort of like, you know what, I'll give this a shot?
I was 18 and I was just like, whatever.
We
like
don't have gut feelings.
I had no gut. I was just, I did have a gut though. Now in retrospect, there was a gut feeling that made me go that direction. Mm. But like thinking back then, it was just like, you know, when you're 18 years old, you're just like, whatever. Like,
so you didn't really have to interview or anything, or you didn't turn in your resume.
There was nothing. It was just a bedroom with a door as a desk.
So good.
That was it.
And a sticker. And I still love somebody, Big Tony had said he saw you at one point, and I like this story because he said he saw Troy down at the beach. And do you remember this? He said he saw you and you were checking in for a contest, and he had the Volcom sticker on your board. And Tony's like, I don't know if you know guys, no Big Tony, but he's big and he runs security at all the events for all the time. He's like, hey, Troy, he's like, what's that? You know, and Troy goes, it's something new, you know. And I think he said that's all you said was, this is something new. Check, you know, keep your eye on it or something like that. And it, sure enough, it became something.
Yeah.
But did you ever have any idea of what Volcom would become? I mean, how long before you started to kind of wonder and say, hey, maybe there's something going on here?
I had no idea.
Really?
We were just like having so much fun, and it was such a passionate thing and natural thing and authentic thing at the time. It was just, we were all just like a group having so much fun.
Well, let's dive into those early days and maybe give us a little, some insight. I mean, there's a lot of, you know, old friends here who were there for a lot of those early years. You know, you look around, there's a lot of these guys were there with you. So what was the energy like as Volcom was starting in the early 90s, you know, and what was it like? Anything? How did it compare to Quicksilver? How did it compare to the other brands?
Yeah.
What was the experience like for you guys?
Oh man, it was just, I felt like we just did everything we wanted to do and didn't really care what anybody thought. At the end of the day, it was just like we were just on a mission sort of to have fun and create something that was super different to what was going on at the time. It was just, everything was completely the opposite of what was happening in the surf industry. I mean, the shorts were like past the ankles with like the horny toad pocket, and just, I mean, everything about it was just like whacked. I mean, looking back on those shorts and the products that we sold in the beginning, it's just like incredible that we even pulled it off.
Yeah.
You know?
What were some of the earliest memories you have of selling product though? And what,
I mean, you know, I was sort of behind the scenes a little bit. I wasn't so much on the front line sales wise. I was like, I mean, my day consisted of in the morning I would ship from like 9 till maybe noon, or actually maybe it was reversed. I would ship from 9 till noon, get all the boxes ready, and then I'd do sort of at the time marketing, you know. So I was doing shipping and marketing, and then Wooly's like, you need to go pick up some hats in LA or do this or do that. And I just run to LA and just be a gopher and do whatever. It just was anything and everything, basically.
So at that point, there's one of the early photos up there on the wall. But I mean, what did marketing consist of, right? Because there weren't computers.
No computers.
You weren't doing any social media.
No social media, no websites, no nothing.
There wasn't anything.
No.
What was marketing like?
They're called Franklins, and they were like these big, huge, just like obnoxious, like notebooks, yeah. You know? And that was like our computer.
The Franklin
basically was
more than a notebook.
Oh, yeah.
Though, right? Remember?
Yeah. Yeah.
Wooly would always...
Wooly still rocks the Franklin.
I know. Does anybody have a Franklin? Does anybody still use a Franklin? It's all the Volcom people.
I love it.
So Franklin is, I mean, it's an organization. It's a business model. Wow. And it's a, you know, organize calendars. What's that?
Franklin Covey, exactly.
Exactly.
Yeah, Wooly used to, the budgets were literally on these graph papers. Like, he just had his whole financial, like, it was like graph papers and pencils and erasers.
Yeah.
It was crazy.
One of my earliest memories of working with Wooly was pencils and erasers. Like, he was like, write, erase, and like, and he's like
And his dad completely held out on computers. Like, computers were starting to kind of come around, and Wooly's dad was so old school. He's like, no computers.
It'll never
for like
catch.
Years.
Oh man.
Yeah, it was classic.
So at what point though? So it starts to grow though. More employees come, and you move. Where was the first building at that you were in?
The first building was on Brioso, so just down the road, and it was such a hodgepodge deal. It was like this carved off, not even a corner of a warehouse kind of setup. This guy basically sublet to Wooly, and we literally made like a little it wasn't even a warehouse. It was like literally, it was like the warehouse was as big as this stage right here. It was three racks with like double levels, and it was like you had your, you know, the board shorts and the t-shirts, and I mean, that was it. And there was like this little office with like a little crooked window that we put in there. So
good.
Yeah, that was the first office. And then the second office was over here on production, just like right around the corner.
Is that 858 or the
858.
Yep. Okay.
Or no, sorry. No, it was on Placentia.
Yeah.
1955, I think, or something like that. What was it, Ian?
Actually, production.
Okay.
But not 858.
Yeah, the corner one. I forget what that one was, but yeah, that was the second one.
And who were you? Do you guys remember some of the? What was the scene like back then? I mean, what were some of the accounts? What were the magazines? Who were you working with?
We had a mini ramp in the middle of the warehouse, so it was like just skateboarding and like some shipping and some marketing and some production, and like there wasn't all that much working going on in the early days, honestly.
Yeah.
It was just kind of like we were just raging, having fun.
And so I do think, I mean, this is really tough because like to keep this confined into a certain amount of time, and we can go down the avenue of how Volcom became what it did and at what point it turned, you know, because at some point you go from that sort of makeshift, and you keep moving to a new office. You move down the road to a nicer office, 858 production place, right? Mm-hmm. But you're with the company as it starts to grow. And do you start to sense that things are changing? At what point do you start to say it's like, whoa, it doesn't have necessarily, things are progressing a little bit here?
I mean, it was probably when we moved into 858. Mm. It was like we actually had a real building with real offices, and there was more people showing up. And that was basically the time when I was like, wow, okay, this thing's got some legs and might go somewhere. That was the time for me, definitely.
And from those, I mean, and actually many, I mean, what did you appreciate most? Those earliest years? Was there sort of a zone within your career there at Volcom? Because ultimately, you're there at Volcom for almost 20 years, more than 20 years. You know, was it the earliest days that were most precious, the middle days, the end days?
I would say the early for sure to like prior until we moved into the Quicksilver building-ish time, mm-hmm. which was 1999.
Yep.
So I would say, you know, probably just before, I would say all the way up until we went public.
Okay.
Yeah.
Maybe we'll talk about that. Maybe we'll talk about that. And so, rattle off a few of your most memorable experiences, some antics maybe that happened or something.
There's too many. I don't even know. Like
something at the top of your
head. I think a fun one probably to talk about would be the first movie that we made. It was called A Lively Ride, mm-hmm. which was the first of many, you know, and I think that really set the tone for like who we were and what we were all about, basically. And we, me and Wooly edited the movie, and it was my first introduction into filmmaking and whatnot. And we were editing it up in Tahoe, and it was like all analog, like there was no digital anything. Everything was tape to tape, and it was just so janky the way you used to edit. And we went in and we were editing, and we had it on an offline, basically, where it was like perfect on a VHS tape. And we go in to sort of sync the beta tapes, which is the higher quality tapes at the time, and everything was off, completely off. All the music was off. So we had to literally like start from scratch and re-edit the entire movie while we had a premiere set up at the second building. And we literally like pulled it off, flew to the flight. We were like getting on the last flight to Orange County and somehow like made it on. And like we had the tape in hand, literally just got like someone picked us up, just straight to the party. There's people everywhere, literally put it in and play it. And it was like,
and it worked.
It was insane. It totally worked. That's but it was awesome. Like, for me, that was, I remember it being just like such a critical moment of like, holy shit. Like this is the real deal right here. And I don't know, it's something that really stuck out for me, definitely in the early days.
Was it the hustle of getting that done, deadline, or coming and having people there waiting for you?
I think it was all of it. And plus we, like the movie, we just knew that this thing was insane and people needed to see it.
Yeah.
So we were just like proud of it. And like, if we would have missed that flight, it would have been a moment that we just would have missed. You know what I mean? So who knows what would have happened, whatever, it would have happened eventually, but like, we could have missed that moment.
Yeah,
so for me, that was a big, big little moment.
And how about the party? I mean, so parties were a big part of Volcom, mm-hmm. right? There was always an excuse for a party.
Definitely.
And was that a big one? Is that one of your...
No, I mean, that was the beginning. It was just like a bunch of kids in a parking lot, just like hanging out. It was killer.
It seems
though.
Like a lot of our parties there were a bunch of kids in the parking lot.
A lot of kids in the parking lot. Yeah, absolutely.
So tell me then some of your... I mean, there were obviously so many highs and lows there through your career there, but... Whether you have any of your funnest moments, saddest moments, biggest decisions, worst decisions, any highlights?
Which one do you want to talk about first?
I don't know. Any votes out there? How about your the biggest decision you had to make while you were there at Volcom?
The biggest decision? I don't know. There was kind of a lot of them. Gosh, I don't know. Maybe sponsoring a new athlete for a ton of money, or like, you know, when we got to that point of like, okay, this is what we're doing. We're sponsoring professional athletes, and it costs money. And
what was that like? I mean, that's something that's got to be really interesting, right? Mm-hmm. All of a sudden, you're maturing into a role where you become in charge of that program. Your mm-hmm. job is to sign world class athletes.
Yeah.
What is that experience like?
That was super fun and cool. And I feel like I could relate to them because I was an athlete. And that was one of the biggest, the coolest parts of my job was to really like sign athletes and just become their friends and help them along with their careers and, you know, go through their trials and tribulations and try to guide them and things like that. So I loved it. That was one of my favorite parts of the job was the athlete side of it.
And speaking of your job, so you went from packing boxes, shipping out stuff, marketing, did you get to a point where you sort of got an official role, or did it just sort of morph? Do you remember sort of like, whoa, okay, yeah. I have a real job now and I'm getting paid a good salary?
Yeah, it sort of organically happened. I think at that time, nobody knew what we were all going to be good at because we were so young. Like, we were just young. We were young kids. So it was almost like Wooly and his dad and all those guys sort of strategically like brought in this like crew of like 18-year-olds of like, okay, let's see what you guys are going to be good at, basically. So for me, I just sort of gravitated towards marketing, and that was just where I fueled, or where it was, you know, fueling for me, and I loved it, and yeah, that's where I ended up.
So you stuck with that role the entire time. Tell me what your positions were, if you will.
I mean, it was so loose back in the day. It was like team manager, marketing guy, marketing director, VP of marketing. It was all marketing at the end of the day, but you know, it's all just a title. But at the end of the day, the fundamental reason for me being there was marketing. So.
Did you enjoy getting your VP title?
I didn't really care, honestly.
Really?
No.
All right. Let's see. so though at some point, so you're at the VP level, things are matured, the company now, whether it was, what are we in, 10 years or more, something like that. My math is bad right now, but eventually the company decides to go public. So Volcom goes from a really small little startup working out of Richard's room to a couple small little buildings this size, and eventually it gets to the point where the decision has to be made. And you're part of that decision-making team but at that point, right?
Yeah.
Do we take this company public, right? So at this point, how many millions was, or what, 300, 200? Does anybody remember? I keep looking at Ethan.
Ethan doesn't know.
I mean, you know, but it's a good-sized company at that point. We've got big accounts, and the decision is...
Oh, before we went public.
Yeah, before we went public.
I don't even know.
But that was a big decision, and not many... relatively speaking, people will get that opportunity to be there at the decision-making table to take a company public. Yeah. What is that like? What was it like when Richard first said, hey, I'm thinking this, to all of a sudden, boom, you're on the roadshow, and boom, it's on.
Yeah, it was surreal, and at that time, I was still sort of green to the idea of like, well, what's a public company? What does that even mean?
Yeah.
You know, and so once I really sort of figured out what it really was and what it entailed. And I mean, I knew, but what it really entailed was a heavy deal. I mean, it was a huge transition. It was a huge transition in company culture and, you know, from A to Z basically. And, you know, from a financial side, it's like the reporting and just like, I mean, everything's literally public, you know, all of a sudden you're just like, everything's out there. So
kind of like your life right now.
What's that?
I said, it's kind of like your life right now.
Yeah. Basically we're taking right at this moment.
But yeah. I mean, was that, so the transition though, how did was there a huge culture change? Do you remember that specifically?
Yeah, you know, I think we actually navigated it pretty well. Like I kind of thought it was going to be worse than it ended up being couple years after that. I mean, for me personally, I know maybe for other people it was different, but I was just envisioning like, oh God, we're going public and it's just, you know, we've sold out and everything's just going to, it's just the company's going to go away. Like you have these like thoughts, you know, or whatever. It's just, but that's really not the case. And I mean, ultimately it definitely was able to fuel us to sort of that next phase. And I mean, that was the reason why we went public, is to sort of compete with the bigger companies and stuff. So
good decision, would you say? Right decision?
That's a tough question.
Subjective?
That's very subjective. But
do you ever look back at a particular point and look at it as your big break? You know, any of those stages along, do you ever feel like you had a big break?
Not really. I don't know. I was just like along for the ride, honestly. I was just doing my thing. I just had my head down with the team and, you know, building, you know, a great marketing team and creative team. You know, that was for me like what was awesome was to be able to like work with people that I wanted to work with every single day. And like we had our head down. We weren't like, oh, we're so cool or whatever. It was like we were down to business and just getting it done. So,
and I know even from the conversations you and I have had too, but I know one of the big takeaways from Volcom and just your experience there from that long career were the relationships that you built.
Yeah, absolutely.
How important are relationships in general?
Everything. Like for me, taking away, you know, or just thinking about, and my takeaway from Volcom is like all the people that I've gotten a chance to work with and build like incredible bonds and friendships with. I mean, I still have them to this day and I'll cherish those forever, and you can never get rid of those, you know? So for me, that's one of my coolest takeaways was the relationships that were built over the years, for sure.
Yeah. And how about also in that experience, I mean, you're getting the opportunity to meet some of the legends, you know? I mean, you're in an industry now that you've grown to love and admire, and at one point you're watching magazines and now you're calling some of these guys and working with these people. What are some of the legendary names that you remember meeting and getting to meet along the way?
I mean, you know, just a lot of the surfers and snowboarders, and obviously working with a lot of those guys. I mean, yeah, it was incredible. I mean, the list is super long, and I mean, the most classic ones are like a lot of the Hawaiians that you know that you have heard about, and then they come in and you're like intimidated and that whole sort of thing. But at the end of the day, they're all pretty mellow guys, so that was fun.
Musicians, celebrities?
A lot of musicians, yeah.
Who's your favorite musician that you met?
Dave Lombardo from Slayer, for sure. The drummer of Slayer would be one of my favorites, 100%.
How did that come about?
I don't even remember how that came about, actually. It's just kind of, he kind of appeared. No, but I don't know. It's just a hardcore band, but like at the end of the day, he was like the most genuine dude ever. And just as far as like a musician, and I played drums my whole life, so I'd always looked up to him. And then when he came in, it was pretty cool. And then him being just like a genuinely amazing person was just like the cherry on top. So
yeah. And how about inspirations? Who were you pulling inspiration from? Whether it was surfers, athletes, musicians, artists, celebrities, what was driving you through those days of your...
I mean, all of it, like, you know, every touch, there's so many touch points.
Yeah.
I mean, like Ethan and creative world and what he built. And I mean, he was a huge part of like the face of Volcom for such a long time. I would draw massive inspiration from him, from, you know, the athletes, from... I mean, Wooly was a huge inspiration, obviously. I mean, he was my mentor for so many years and really taught me all I knew about business. So,
yeah.
I mean, there's so many cool people I got to work with.
And so do you ever get a sense, I mean, for those of you that are, you know, for your friends that know you intimately, it doesn't seem like that a big deal, but for others that are on the outside, but I mean, I guess I want to try to pull out, what is it like? You know, you were on the inside for so many years. You're on the inside of the company. You're on the inside of the professional athlete scene. I mean, is that something that you ever sort of stopped and went, man, I never really looked at that I have access to some of these legendary names? Or does it just sort of become part of life?
It was just sort of natural, I think. You know, it was like I just grew up in it. So it was kind of a natural progression. I mean, yeah, there were definitely times when we were going to sign, you know, other guys, and all of a sudden you're sort of starstruck or whatever a little bit, you know, just because I respect the way, you know, how they are as athletes or people or whatever. But, you know, for the most part, it was pretty natural progression. And
yeah. Okay. So your career is progressing at Volcom, and it's moving along. The company's public. Things are good. Your salary is good. At one point, and I know this one is awkward, or could be, but at one point, Shop Eat Surf, on the talking about public information, says that your new salary is $336,000 a year. And I'm wondering, it's like, what is that like, right? And for everybody, and it's like, you know, what is that like, especially now as an entrepreneur going to making $0 in our new startup, right? But I mean, that's something that very few people are ever going to get a chance to have. And what is that feeling like? What is it, one, to see your name printed like that and go, well, there's my salary, great, and, you know.
Yeah, I wasn't very stoked. I wasn't stoked. All of a sudden, everything's public, and you're just like, oh, okay, well, that's what that guy makes, and you're just like, it just adds a whole element of just, like, awkwardness, and it wasn't a very fun thing for, I think, a lot of people, you know? So, for me, especially, being sort of a private person, I was just like, I wasn't, you know, it is what it is.
Yeah.
That's inherently what happens when you go public, so, but I think, you know, for me, it wasn't, I didn't think anything really more of it. It was what was going on. I don't know. It's a hard one to...
Were there life lessons that you take away from having a salary like that?
If anything, it's definitely an ego check, you know, like all of a sudden you're like, I'm making money, like I'm killing it. And, you know, for me personally, there was definitely a time when I had to check my ego a few times, you know, and got caught up in some stuff, like real estate stuff, and all of a sudden you're like spending money, and then you're just like, and then, you know, that was like right when we went public and everything was great, you know, in 2005, and then 2008, 2009 hits, and all of a sudden it's just like everything tanks, and you just bought a bunch of real estate, and you're like, well, that was a very smart decision, you know, so I think the ego check with that sort of stuff was huge for me, and I know with a lot of other people too, so...
So at what point, and at that point, as you start to finish though too, and I wonder, do you ever start to think about, I mean, as the company goes public and you're a third employee, you've got a lot of stock options, you've got a lot of stock in the company, but do you ever think of retiring? Did you get to a point where you're just like, you know what, I'm out of here?
Well, I mean, I eventually did leave, but it wasn't like, I'm going to go retire. Like when I left, I mean, that was 6 or 7 years ago. I'm still fairly young in the great sense of like a work, you know, working for your lifetime. And no, I never thought about retiring. You know, everybody would say that, oh, you're going to go retire and all this. I'm like, yeah, there's no way. I'm like, I have way too much fire to like retire.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, tell us at least about what was it like that when you started to realize that maybe it was time for your next chapter outside of Volcom?
Yeah, I think it was around 2008, 2009 was sort of when I was, you know, I had probably I don't know, 30 people under me that I was managing, and it ended up being like a pretty big management position versus like a creative position at that mm-hmm. point. So I think it was kind of around those times when I was feeling a little bit burnt, starting to burn out a little bit, being in the office. I mean, I'd been in the office at that point about 18, 19 years. So, come around 20 years, I'm like, that was kind of my 20 year goal was like, okay, if I can make it to 20 years, I'm doing pretty good. So yeah, it was, yeah.
And so what's your, what was your exit plan? At your 20 year mark, you decide to take a next step, but you didn't just leave.
No.
You kind of did a little in between stage.
Sort of, yeah, like just for like a year. I moved to Hawaii with my family, and we had a position that was like a Hawaii strategic marketing director. So that was sort of the transitioning out position I had for about a year. So.
Once you left though, and you're living in Hawaii and you're doing that, did you kind of get a sense that those days were dwindling and you were slowly?
Yeah.
And starts and what the story behind Cosm is.
I mean, basically, like when I moved back from Kauai, I just gone through a divorce, and that was a really hard time for me in my life. It was basically one of my lowest points, and I was just sort of, I kind of had a hiatus from the yoga thing a little bit for a minute, and then once I got back here, I really got back into it. And it was just literally one day I like walked out, and I'm wearing board shorts, and I was like, I want to go find some like proper whatever yoga shorts, to practice in, and I couldn't find anything, and I just started like thinking about it, and I started talking to some friends, and I just felt like there was sort of a hole in the market, and then ended up calling you and pulling you in under my wing or what have you, and I just decided to go for it. It was very ultimately organic.
Yeah.
Completely organic. So was not planning on starting another brand. I toyed with the idea of starting an action sports brand, another one, but I'm like, there's no way in hell it could repeat another Volcom. And nor do I know what a 15-year-old's talking about or thinking about these days. So it was sort of, it really aligns with like who I am and where I'm at in my life. And it's what I'm passionate about right now is like that, being healthy, surfing and things like that.
And so how about so days at Volcom? And I mean, obviously there has to be that hope of knowing what Volcom did and what's going on at Cosm, and just a few people working on Cosm.
Yeah.
Do you ever just sort of think back constantly to those Volcom days?
Totally. I totally do. It's exciting. I'm passionate about it. It's the road is completely unknown.
Yeah.
Same thing at Volcom back in the day. I mean, we had no idea where we were going or how to get there. So it's kind of the same thing as today.
Yeah.
But still, at the end of the day, you love it and you're stoked to do it, and you wake up and you're fired up. So.
So what maybe from those earliest days, what from what you learned along the way are you constantly reminding yourself of now as you work on Cosm every day and we work to build this brand? What are you constantly reminding yourself of?
Just don't give up, and just continue. I mean, passion is just kind of one of those, it's like cliche words, but if you don't have it, it's hard to do anything on a level that that needs, whatever needs to be done, you have to be passionate about it, and you just got to just go for it wholeheartedly and commit. Commitment is a big thing too.
Yeah.
You can't half-ass it.
Commitment, and tell me about going with your gut too.
Yeah.
What is that to you?
Gut's huge. Like, gut has been a big leader. Gut and heart for me has been a big thing. Both of those things for my whole entire career and just in life in general is like, always go with your gut. And, your gut and your heart kind of seem to know. And it's a lot of times that you make those decisions where, you kind of have a weird feeling in your gut and your heart, and you still make the decision, and all of a sudden it goes sour and you're like, I should have listened to my gut.
Yeah.
I've had so many of those. And, to this day, it's still a challenge because you get caught up in the moment and you're like, yeah, this is going to be incredible. And you partner with somebody or whatever it is, and your gut or your heart is just kind of like talking to you back there, and you don't listen to it. And all of a sudden you're like, should have listened to my gut.
Yeah.
So.
And if you had to give any, especially to maybe any of our young students or aspiring professionals, if you look back, I mean, he had a great career at Volcom. You've had a great opportunity building a new brand and starting something new. What advice do you have for people at different stages of their careers?
I mean, I would just do get into something that you really enjoy, because if you're not having fun, you know, really in any aspect of your life, I think, why are you wasting your time with it? Mm-hmm. So getting into something you're very passionate about and like stoked to be a part of, you know, and yeah, I think that's a big part of getting into a career or whatnot. I think it's, you gotta be really like into it, you know, you gotta be into it, be wholeheartedly into it. Don't just do it just to do it. Like be into it.
Work with like-minded people.
Yeah, if you can. I mean, I know when you're younger, you're kind of doing what you gotta do just to get, you know, get exposure, get experience, things like that. But ultimately don't waste your time too much on that. You know, find where you wanna be and you'll figure it out and then just go for it.
So talk to me about work-life balance. And just kind of finding a balance, staying in tune, staying healthy. Talk to us about that.
Now more important than ever is like, you know, health and all that comes first, especially, I mean, we're getting older. As we get older, it's like, I think for young people, like if I would have known now what, you know, the old saying, if I would have known now and applied it back then, it would be definitely different, you know, as far as taking care of myself. I mean, when you're younger, you're sort of invincible though, so you can kind of, you know, F off a bit more.
Yeah.
But at the end of the day, take care of yourself. And that's basically what I, for me, is a big part of like my regimen is like definitely taking care of your health first, you know, and like your vessel is your number one. So everything else sort of falls by the wayside. If you're not healthy and, you know, if you're, you know, hungover every single day, I mean, yeah, you can pull that off for a little bit, but after a while, it's going to catch up to you.
Yeah.
I mean, I've had plenty of those days too. Don't get me wrong.
Walk us through your routine a little bit of what's keeping you in form.
I mean, just, you know, try to do yoga as much as I can, you know, 3 days a week and, some breathing stuff and, you know, eating well is huge, obviously, your fuel. And then just, you know, work, but also to make sure you take time to enjoy yourself too. I think that's just keep your soul. You got to keep the soul happy, you know, from so many different levels. So,
yeah,
I mean, I want to actually tighten up my routine a little bit more, but it's just always an ongoing thing, you know, as you get older and you develop as a human being, you know, you're always fine tuning your process. So,
and so as you've gotten older, so as we're 40-somethings. does that play a part in it? Do you ever trip out on that at all? Starting a new brand at 40-something?
No, not that so much. Like, I mean, my mind, I feel like it's going to be around for a lot longer than my body is. So it's more so like wanting to take care of myself more than ever so I can like be active and like surf the waves. I want to still surf. I think, you know, my mind can surf. I want to continue to like do that for a long time, and like for me, like yoga and healthy living sort of like been the thing that's really the catalyst to help me do that.
Yeah.
So for me, that's a big deal.
So tell people, kind of in a nutshell, then that don't know, tell them about the Cosm brand. What is Cosm? What is?
Why don't you tell them, Derek?
No. This is your talk. I'm the question giver. But I don't think we got that, you know. So the people don't know, you know, what is the brand that you built? I mean, this was your idea, your concept.
I mean, at the end of the day, it's a men's yoga lifestyle brand, basically, you know. I feel like that there's sort of a hole in the market, and I mean, I didn't really want to wear Lululemon, and a lot of the guys that I know don't. So, you know, I feel like there's a midway ground there, and you know, it's the sustainable model is a huge part of it. It's about doing business the right way. It's about transparency. You know, we're showing our costing. We're literally like an open book. So it's sort of, you know, it's what's happening today. And so we've sort of taken the approach from so many different levels, from the way we registered the company as a B Corp and, you know, going for the B Corp certification process, and even the bank we pick, you know, they have ethical standards behind them. So there's all these different levels of things that we're doing that's very difficult, but very meaningful at the end of the day. So that's what we're trying to do with Cosm.
Right? What's really funny is as you're talking, my head is already like, so tomorrow, I already know what we have to do. Like, there's already, I know what questions are going to come up. So tell me about what's the end game like? Do you have an end vision? Is there something that sort of drives you? Like, for me, I always have this one life scene in my head.
What's your life scene?
No. I'm not in that chair yet. But is there something, though, that kind of keeps you, it's like, hey, that is where I'm going, that's where I want to be, and that's where I'm going to end up no matter what?
No.
Like, is it a dollar mark?
No,
is
absolutely
it a feeling?
Not.
Is it a place
feeling.
You're living?
Yeah. It's a feeling. It's being happy. Like, just being content and happy. Like, it's just, that's it. It's so, it's just, keep it simple. Like,
Does money equal happiness?
No, absolutely not. No. Money equals misery in a lot of places, for sure. Like, more money, more problems. I'm a firm believer of that. I mean, yeah.
Cool.
So, yeah.
So I'm gonna do a couple. So we'll open it up for a little bit of Q&A if anybody's got any questions too. But I've got a couple quick round of questions that I wanna ask you. When do you feel most human?
When do I feel most human? In the barrel.
In the barrel.
Yeah.
What was the best barrel experience you've ever had?
I don't know. That one they're showing is pretty good. That was a little bit ago.
The video clip. This one right here. Was that the same?
That's the same
wave. That's the same wave. Okay, so that wave is available on outlets all over the place. Okay, here's the next question.
It's available on DVD.
For $9.99. If you just come see me at the end of the show, you've just won a 15-day travel package to anywhere in the world. Where are you going? What are you doing?
Where am I going? What am I doing? I'm definitely going surfing, and I'm probably going to Tavarua, even though I've been there a million times.
A million and one.
I have to go back.
Podcasts or books? Which are you doing right now?
Both. I love both.
What's your What's the hottest? What are your two faves?
I'm into this guy Rich Roll, podcast guy. He's a vegan runner, decathlon guy. He's amazing.
What's his name?
Rich Roll.
Rich Wall.
Rich Roll. R O L L.
Okay. Rich
Roll. And then I just finished a book called Essentialism. It's really cool.
Which you gave me as homework to read as well.
Yeah, you got to read Essentialism.
First album cover that comes to mind.
Ozzy Osbourne, Blizzard of Oz.
Okay, here's another one. Magically, the universe has allowed you to organize a dinner party with all the members of any band, any time period. Who are you inviting, and who's preparing the meal?
Wait, repeat that again.
Magically, the universe has allowed you to organize a dinner party with all the members of a band from any time period. Okay? Who are you inviting and who's preparing the meal?
That's pretty... I would have... I don't know. That's deep. Can you, like, commingle, like, bands?
Yeah, of course.
I would say... Kiss is at the dinner party.
Whoa.
And Robert Plant is... Jimmy Page... No, John Bonham's serving.
Wow. Okay. Yeah. I love that.
Or Jimmy Page.
I wouldn't have
Robert
guessed
Plant.
That. That's amazing. Okay. Yeah. Here's maybe my last one. You're going back in time. You're dropped off as you are. Actually, scratch that from the record. You're paddling out at any wave, any time period, and with anyone. Describe your experience. You're time traveling. You're dropped off any wave, paddling out with anybody. Where are you? Who are you with?
I'm at Uluwatu, even though I've never surfed there before, but I'm with Jerry in probably the year I was born, 1972.
Awesome.
I just aged myself. Shit.
Yeah, it's okay. Damn. I'm right there with you. We're a couple of old guys up here talking story. So that's my list of questions. I want to open it up, but first I want to give you a round of applause, say thank you for the experiences. But I would imagine there might be a couple other questions if you guys want to continue the conversation with Troy. Does anybody have any questions they want to throw out to our esteemed guest here?
We can go to the bar. It's cool.
We can go to the bar. We can keep drinking. What do we got? Questions. Anybody have a question? Whether it's career-related, Vulcan-related, Cosm-related, surfing-related.
Come on, Ethan. Ted.
Yeah, Ted.
Of course, Ted.
Yeah.
Is there anything you'd change, like you could go back and do it again?
So the question was, is there anything you would change if you could go back and do it again? Is there anything you would change?
No, I wouldn't. No, I wouldn't change anything. Maybe a couple of things, but not really. No, I'm just kidding. No, I wouldn't change anything. Definitely not.
And how about, let's talk fatherhood real quick, too. Tell us about your girls.
Yeah, I have three daughters. They are 6.5, 8.5, and 10.5, and they teach me a lot every single day. It's incredible being a father.
Yeah.
I love it. It's intense and crazy and wild and out of control, but it's epic. Excuse me. Keeps you human. Keeps you grounded.
There we go. That's the time when you feel most human.
Yeah, or vulnerable, or, yeah.
As a father.
Definitely. Dr. Tim. Oh.
So the question was, what do we feel, what does Troy feel sets the brand apart from the rest that are already out there? What's the differentiating factor?
I mean, there's I guess at the end of the day, there's a lot more meaning and thought, but there's thought in a lot of brands as well, but I don't know, that's a really good question, and I think that at the end of the day, it feels really good to wear.
Aesthetic,
for sure. And just the building blocks of like how we developed the brand and just everything that went into it, really. Yeah, definitely.
Yeah.
I don't know if that was a good answer, but.
How about David in the middle, UCI?
I think a lot of young people would equate going public with being successful. How do you see that?
I wouldn't say so. I wouldn't agree with that. You know, I think it's just a different path. There's so many different paths of running a company. It's like, what do you do? Do you continue to be private forever? There's shareholders that, you know, want to see return on the investment. So it's just kind of, definitely, to answer your question, going public does not mean success to me. No, definitely not. No.
And there are companies that we know. I mean, Patagonia, to me, is always the great example of a company who refuses to go public and who refuses to worry about growing quarterly or year-over-year earning, you know, profits. It doesn't matter. It's all about staying true to the original vision.
Yeah, and I'm not knocking what we did.
Of course.
By any means. I mean, it is what it is, and I think it gave us a lot of fuel to sort of compete at the time, because it was a different game back then with the whole brick-and-mortar and retail.
Yeah.
You know, you had to pay to play. You had to get in there and sort of, you know, show some muscle financially to be able to compete with Quiksilver and Billabong at the time, who were huge then.
And I think the interesting thing, too, at the time was, I know Volcom was really perceived as being just as big as everybody else, but we weren't. You know,
no.
We didn't have the same purchasing power or the same marketing dollars. But to the consumer, everybody's like, oh, well, of course you guys are. So you had to play at that level in order to maintain right, the pace that you were at. So
yeah.
It was a required thing almost.
It was a conscious decision for sure. Yeah.
I know
anybody else?
Daniel Terry.
Daniel.
It's a tough one, but what are your thoughts
about,
like, looking in from the outside after a couple of years? Just curious.
Oh.
To be honest.
Yeah, no, I won't be honest. No, I'm just kidding. Of course I'll be honest. Well, it's interesting because you're such a part of the process from the beginning. It's like, you know, you're watching your baby grow up until they're 20 and then sort of like, you know, splitting up or they're going to do their own thing. And then you see them do things that you're just like, oh, okay, that's interesting that you might not necessarily agree with, but then there's other things you might. And I mean, it's just a different time. Like, you know, the things that have been done, is it how I would have done it? Probably not. But at the same time, like, I appreciate the intent to keep Volcom. And I think that everybody's doing a really good job at this point to really try to do that. And I think guys like yourself and like Imigar and the guys that have been there from day one to be in there still is like saying a lot, I think. So more power to you guys. Keep it up. Definitely.
What else? How about over here?
Cosm. So it sort of came from cosmic, just worldly, universal, and just, you know, change the C, the K, got rid of the S, the Z. So cosmic, basically, spacey, space.
And we there was a code, the way the letters stacked, and we always, there's a fun little, if you look in there, a couple of things that we kept noticing, and it's been this way, a few things along the way, right? There was the figure that's in there, the man.
Yeah, it's like the man, the O,
the head and the
M
shoulders.
With the Om.
And it says Om. And it just kind of kept saying, this is the brand, this is the name, this is the right thing.
Yeah.
Right? back here in the middle. Christian.
Yeah. I think that, honestly, I looked at what Volcom did and just a lot of the things I learned from there, and I wanted to do things differently. And I think also in the yoga space, I think that there's a lot of just product being made wherever, whatever, it doesn't really matter. At the end of the day, I wanted it to be a benefit corp. Because at the end of the day, it's about, you know, benefit for people and planet. So, I mean, it was a conscious decision to really set it up that way. And, did I answer your question?
I can add to that, though.
Please
can,
add to that.
Yeah, I can add to that, though.
Sustainability, because, I didn't touch on that. But Derek hit that.
But in the earliest conversations, though, too, is what, you know, I remember you just saying, it's like, yeah, but I don't want to just start another brand. Like, I really don't want to just make another brand. So we sort of kept going through. It's like, what are all the boxes we can check at every stage? So every time we're going to do something, it's like, are we doing it the right way? And is that sort of the, are we moving the needle all the way over to be able to say, we feel really good about that?
Yeah.
And the earliest thing we had to do was form a corporation. It's like, okay, what's the best way to do it? What bank do we want to use? Yeah. How do we corporate? You know, it's like Benefit Corp, choose the bank. You know, we just kept going down the list. But you didn't want to just do another company. Right?
Yeah, and I leaned on Derek a lot on the sustainability, obviously, because that's his expertise. I think it's just the way that we want to do things and the way I think it needs to be done moving forward, just with like our day and age and the way we're being so wasteful. And, you know, it's just like if we're going to start a business, let's start it mindfully and really give a shit at the end of the day.
Yeah.
So.
Mr. Schmidt.
Yeah. B Corp is a benefit corporation. So, you can set it up as an S Corp or a C Corp or an LLC under the umbrella of B Corp. So it's a benefit corporation. So basically, really what it comes down to is social and environmental. Things basically are at the top of the list as far as like with your bylaws. You can create bylaws of like X, Y, and Z, you know, whatever it is when it comes to being a benefit to the environment and socially. And those bylaws stick with you if any sort of event happened, if it was an acquisition, if it was going public or anything like that. Those, you know, public benefits would always stick with the company. So it's not necessarily a for-profit model. So it's about the benefits of
people and planet. It sort of protects you and allows you to sort of operate with the with sustainability in mind, benefiting the environment, benefiting people, as opposed to just primarily focusing on profit. So typically, as a regular corporation, your goal is beholden to the shareholders, and you're almost required to show profit and say that, hey, you're doing the best interest of the shareholders. Where being a benefit corp sort of protects you and says, hey, we're also allow people, planet, profit, and kind of looking at other things besides just profit.
So basically, it's a .org, it's a true .org in the economic sense.
A little bit, but it's also a legal registration that you can have.
Yeah, so it is for profit at the end of the day.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Yeah.
Problem. You're welcome. Yeah.
I want to do Pat. Yeah.
Like, how are you sorting that?
What is the demographic? It's, I mean, age-wise, it's, I would say it's like 35 to 45. So it's definitely like an older male and female if she wants to rock it. But it's like definitely like, it's like us at the end of the day. Like we're marketing to us, you know, and that was a big reason why it felt right, because I was marketing to myself at the end of the day. Just like at Volcom when I was 18 or whatever, I was marketing to myself. So it was supernatural. So that's the age bracket at the end of the day. Yeah.
Who was in the back, all the way in the back there?
So let's say, you know, you've got your brand, you found your space, you kind of have your mission. Like, what does that first year look like? If you have practical stuff like manufacturer, how to get a place. What does that initial start of the journey look like, even now,
That's a great question. It's polar opposite. I mean, not so much in the sense of manufacturing. It's actually, there is similarities right now with what we're doing with Cosm, because we're making it in the US and sustainably made, so everything's super expensive to make. I'm doing production runs up in Carson, which I did at Volcom back in 1991. Like, same zones. It's like totally, it's the same thing. But on the marketing side, I mean, you're talking about completely two different universes, obviously. I mean, we were, advertising in magazines and that sort of stuff. And, you know, there was nothing, there was no social media, none of that stuff. So it's been a massive learning curve for us as well on that space. So yeah, it's hugely been exciting, scary, informative, educational. I mean, it's all the above. So, I mean, it's been an incredible experience thus far. And we've learned so much in the last year and a half that we've been building this thing. And I mean, we're just getting it going, and it's just been incredible. So yeah, completely polar opposite time. It's a trip, completely.
Hey, June.
Hi.
What are the pros and cons of working for a startup at such a young age? Like starting with Volcom at like 18 years old.
Pros and cons.
I don't think there's any cons.
Yeah, nothing to lose at that point.
I think it's all pros. I mean, maybe there's some cons. At that point, I was just like, I was so in it and so young. It was just like a fun time. The experience that you get at that young age, being able to get involved at a startup, I mean, it'd be hard to go to college and get that sort of education. Not that I'm, saying that college is a bad thing. It's obviously a super good thing. But at the same time, like for me, I didn't go to college. Like I graduated high school and I was done. I was just like, I was in the school of Volcom for the next 20 years, basically. So I was lucky, timing, right place, right time, all that sort of thing. But I don't see there being too many cons. I mean, if you find the right startup and you can get in there and really like get under the hood and get it going with them at that point in time, I think that that's a good thing. Yeah.
And I'd say pros, you're going to learn so much.
Yeah.
You're getting an opportunity to get your hands on so many different
things. It's real life. It's real experience. It's not just textbooks and things like that. I mean, yeah, you're really like real problems that you have to solve. Yeah. Yes.
Yeah. Where does he see Cosm in the next 5 years? Where does he see himself and Cosm in the next 5 years?
I mean, I hope we're just creating a really meaningful, purposeful brand that people love at the end of the day, and something that I can work on, or we can work on for the next 10 plus years, like a heritage brand at the end of the day. I think that's what our hope is for. And we just want to have fun doing it and do it authentically and have some meaning behind it, for sure.
Yeah.
So, yeah. It's not a big, like, built-to-sell thing. It's just, like, we want to build something that's, like, can stand the test of time at the end of the day. Yeah.
Anybody else? Any other questions? Well, you guys, thank you very much. Thank you for being here at our next last event. Troy Eckert, thank you very much.
Thank you, man.
I need water. And you guys, check back on the Boathouse website, social media. We do this once a month. We bring new guests. But that was an amazing story. Thank you for sharing with it.
Thank you, D-Money.
With us. And
D-Money.
Thank you for being here.
Thanks, brother.
Hey, buddy.